Lexus. It's a brand that you still don't see that often in the UK. Well, certainly when you compare them to their German counterparts. The thing is, though, the cars they make are what 90% of people should actually be wanting and buying. Let me show you with this 2014 Lexus IS300h. My name's Tom, and you're watching Paragon Cars. Let's go. Before we start, please like, subscribe, and hit the bell if you'd like us to keep bringing you this content. Also, don't forget to follow our socials for updates on our stock. Links in the description below. This is a premier Lexus IS300h. The premier means a lush, well-kitted out interior, and the IS300 means a 2.5-litre hybridised V6 under the bonnet. The V6 combined with the electric motor puts out 223 brake horsepower, which isn't to be sniffed at. Although at 1.7 tonnes, it's no lightweight, so let's see how it does on the 30-70 sprint. Well, typically, the draggy wasn't having a good day today, so even after many attempts, I couldn't get a valid reading, unfortunately. However, run after run, this thing did almost exactly 7.26 seconds every time, which, whilst not fast, certainly isn't slow either. Plus, the response of the drivetrain makes it feel a lot faster than it is, as you're not waiting for a gearbox to downshift. Moving on to the inside, you'll find a plush leather interior, heated and ventilated seats, and build quality that makes some of the other premium brands look a bit subpar in my opinion. One thing that surprised me the most, though, was just how well this interior has aged. This car is coming up to 9 years old now, and everything still looks fairly new. If you told me this car was from 2019, I'd probably just about believe you. The only downside to most Lexuses of this era is their infotainment system, as well, it certainly leaves something to be desired. I don't know who thought having a janky joystick was a good idea. It's like trying to play an arcade game that is just simply broken. Let's get away from that atrocity though and check out the rear, as it's actually a pretty nice place to spend time. There's plenty of leg and headroom for a car of this size, there's even your own armrest with cup holders and a climate vent. Unfortunately, like the infotainment, the boot leaves something to be desired as well. With the seats up, it's okay, but if you need to carry longer items, you're gonna struggle as, yeah, you've got a very unflat load floor. Anyway, let's go for a drive and see why this is a saloon you should really consider. Right, behind the driver's seat, how does this thing feel round town? Well, surprisingly, the first thing you notice is that it's got pretty positive steering, which means if I let go of the wheel, it wants to turn into a corner, which is kind of like a BMW. So already, driving dynamics wise, it feels pretty good. Throttle pedal is easy to modulate. The only thing that I'm having difficulty with so far is the brake pedal. That transition between the KERS system, or the regen system, and the actual brake disc is pretty sharp. Now, this car is from 2014, so it would be not as well calibrated as when it was new. But it's just something I'm noticing. We're just driving around in normal at the minute. And yeah, other than the brake, it feels really smooth to drive. The suspension feels unbelievably solid as well. It just has this like chunky feel to it. Like, you go over bumps, there's no squeaks or rattles. So far, just feels like a really solidly built car, which pretty much all Lexuses do. Now then, in terms of parking, how does it fare? Well, this is a fairly similar size to a BMW 3 Series or an Audi A4. It's that kind of small saloon. This Premier Edition gets a reverse camera and parking sensors as standard. And as you can see, the reverse camera has lines telling you where you're going to go. Car's got plenty of steering lock as well, so it just makes parking an absolute breeze. Plus, once you're in the space, it's very easy to get out, as the car itself isn't that big. I love that noise it makes as well. The transition from electric power to the engine is just so smooth. I have to say, their calibration is much better than some of the German counterparts. Like coming out of this junction now, half throttle, engine's straight there, ready. You're not waiting for power. You just go straight up to 30. Like, you know, you're never going to miss a gap in traffic in London in this thing. So even though it's not technically as fast as something like a 330e, like a BMW 330e, or like the Audi equivalent, I don't think they make a hybrid A4 yet, do they? Or maybe they do. But you're never waiting for like a gearbox to sort of catch up with what you're asking for. This car just goes straight away. And I think that actually makes a huge difference into just the drivability of the car, especially because it's a hybrid. Right, let's reset our trip computer and see what MPG we can get on the motorway. Now, Lexus claims this will do 61.4 miles per gallon on the extra urban cycle, and combined, it's supposed to do around the same. Because of the way this system works, it means you're going to get a high MPG figure no matter where you are. So if you've watched the Lexus CT200h review that I've done, if not, I'll put a link up in the top right hand corner. But that was doing like 40 to 50 miles per gallon around town. But once you're on the motorway, it doesn't go above that. So it's just always sitting at like that high MPG figure. Which is why these are brilliant for around town. And that's why Uber drivers drive Toyota Priuses, because it uses the same kind of technology. So from driving around town, we know that the steering is positive and it's fairly similar to a BMW. What's the chassis like though? Let's have a quick taste of the handling before we get on the motorway. Okay, so it's a rear wheel drive. We have a sports mode, which changes the dials into this normal tachometer. And we can put the traction into sports, though I think you have to hold it down. For some reason, Lexuses don't like it when you turn the traction off. They never seem to let me do it. I don't know why. Anyway, we can use the fake paddles to mimic a normal gearbox. And give it some. And yeah, you do feel that it's rear-wheel drive. And the other thing you notice is that it's a fairly nippy car. Now, yes, it does have flappy paddles, but they're only really good for, like, mimicking a downshift rather than upshift. Because if you have your foot down, the CVT gearbox just keeps itself in, like, the optimal power range, so you can't really upshift with it. I'll show you what I mean when we get onto the motorway. So, look, coming onto the motorway now, if I downshift, there we go, it like mimics a downshift. I can downshift again, this is like first gear, but then if I put my foot down and then change up a gear, pressing the paddle and nothing. So it's like a semi like realistic gearbox, I'd say, but it won't do upshifts if you've got your foot down. It'll do it if you're like at half throttle though. Anyway, before I get too carried away, let's go into Eco and see if we can get that 61 mpg figure. Alright, on the motorway then, I am going to try and give this Lexus a fair chance at getting to that 61 mpg figure. So, I'm going to drive around like 56 to 60 miles an hour, similar to a lorry, and just see if we can get there. Whilst we're doing that, let's have a quick chat about stuff like road noise and wind noise. So, the road noise and wind noise of this Lexus are pretty much identical to that of an Audi A4, certainly from my perception of driving it. And that means it's very good, it's very quiet, and it's unbelievably relaxing to drive. You know, the combination of that very smooth power band that's just always there, always ready, and the quietness of the cabin make this probably one of the better motorway cars to travel in. Steering settles down as well, it's not, you know, tramlining like BMW does, even though it does have positive steering. All the controls have a lovely weight to them, so they never do anything that's unexpected. And all that combines into making this a really pleasurable car to drive over long distances. The only thing I will say is this, the cruise control system fitted to this car is very rudimentary. Even in latter Lexuses, the adaptive cruise control system would only work above like 30 miles an hour, which kind of made it pointless in some sense. So yeah, if you are looking for a car that drives itself well, you need to get a fairly new Lexus or a new Lexus. But if you like driving the car yourself, then this is perfect for you. Then in terms of visibility and response, visibility is good, you've got a blind spot monitor, and response-wise, it's just instant. you get the electric motor come in instantly, and that's got enough torque to actually accelerate you pretty quickly from like 50 to 60. And then the engine is only like half a second behind. Because it's a CVT, you're not waiting for an actual downshift, you're just waiting for the engine to rev up pretty much. So look, we're sitting at 55 miles an hour now, or let's go down to 50, say I want to go up to 60, put my foot down, and it's just there. Straight away, you're not waiting for anything. And that's in eco mode as well. If you're in sports mode, it's even more instantaneous. So if you're driving around London and zipping into little gaps in traffic, like on the M25 when it's busy, it's a perfect car really, and it's got just enough power that you're not going to annoy anyone as well. Anyway, moving on to comfort, because this is actually one of the more comfortable cars I've sat in. This is pretty comparable to a Mercedes E-Class Coupe, actually. The seats are nice and wide, yet they hug you at the same time. You've got plenty of room for your legs. I know a lot of cars will look fairly comfortable, but then you get in them and your knees are kind of like up there, even though you're not over 6 foot tall. Plus, the seats actually get nice and low as well. I wasn't expecting this out of a Lexus, but they actually get lower than in an Audi or a Mercedes, certainly from my perception again. And it makes it actually really comfortable to sit in, like surprisingly comfy. You can adjust the pitch of the base. You don't have an extendable bit for your thighs, but it's not the end of the world, as the bottom of the seat is quite long anyway, so you don't really need that. And the steering wheel comes nice and close to you. It's electrically adjustable in this Premier Edition. Also goes up and down quite a lot. So yeah, getting comfortable is not that hard. Also, again, because this is a Premier Edition, when you get out the car, it will lower and move the seat back and retract the steering wheel, so it just makes egress and ingress a little bit easier. But for the motorway, man, oh, what a car. It is unbelievably comfortable to drive. It's just one of those cars you could easily do like an 11-hour journey and you wouldn't even feel it. Okay, enough praise. What is the quality like? Well, annoyingly, I'm gonna have to keep praising it actually, because this car is 8 years old now, nearly 9 years old, and it feels pretty much brand new. I mean, look at this steering wheel. Admittedly, the previous owner was pretty diligent with their maintenance, but even so, this steering wheel would pass for a pretty much brand new car. Like the door cards, the dash, all the soft touch materials are still just as squidgy as when they were new. All the leather is still pretty nice to the touch. There's almost zero wear on the seat bolsters. And yeah, everything just feels super solid still. Even stuff like the dash, there's just, like, trying to find a creak out of this interior is nigh on impossible. It's just unreal how well put together these cars are. Like, if Mercedes is here, Audi and BMW are kind of here, Lexus is, like, another level above. I just can't believe it. So whilst it's not the flashiest interior, I mean, yeah, it is well built, seriously well built. It feels super solid. Like there's no rattles, no creaks from the seat. Yeah, all that ties into making it a very relaxing car to drive. Three choices, what would you get? Well, because obviously you're going to be looking for a used car, it's actually fairly easy. So you've got a couple of different trim levels, the top two being F-Sport and Premier. This came out before they did the Takumi edition, which is kind of like what Premier used to be. So this is a Premier car, so it gives you pretty much everything that you would want. The only other things you can add at the time were like the very new adaptive cruise control system, and there are a couple of other things like a sunroof. But the Premier Edition is basically the one you want to go for, because that gives you heated and ventilated seats, gives you the memory option for the seats as well. Although I think you get that in an F-Sport. I'm not entirely sure though. I think that might be an optional extra in the F-Sport. But it also gives you like a big navigation screen, gives you the very important Mark Levinson sound system, which is an absolute must because it just sounds insanely good. Like, the B&O system in an Audi A4 is very impressive. This is just on another level.
like a totally different level. This is more comparable to a Burmester system, like the tippy top Burmester system in like an S-Class coupe. It's that good. Like even when you turn it all the way up to full volume, it's still perfectly clear. The interior is like still sticking together. The only thing you notice is the rear view mirror shakes a bit, but that's just because it's insanely loud. Like you don't need to use full volume in this sound system because it is that loud. So yeah, if you're looking for one of these, just make sure you can at least get the F-Sport package. Premier package preferably, because it gives you everything you'd ever need. And then if you want a sunroof as well, that's just one more optional extra. Right, we've got a couple more miles to do on the motorway. Let's see if we can get to that 60 figure. Okay, so it wasn't 60 miles per gallon, but it's a 2.5 litre V6 and it is 1.7 tonnes and we've still managed 47 mpg, which for an 8-year-old hybrid is fundamentally still a really decent figure. I have to say I'm impressed. Even though it's not the quoted figure, it's still very impressive. Over a long run, you're going to get like 52, 54 miles per gallon out of this. So yeah, for driving around town and on the motorway, this is probably one of the most efficient saloons you can buy at the minute still. You're certainly not going to get that out of an equivalent performance BMW, Audi or Mercedes. So if you want something that's cheap to run, very nice to drive on the motorway, then yeah, this is the car for you. If you want something that's more exciting though, well, we'll have to find out. Let's go do some driving. Okay, so you know earlier when I was struggling to turn off the traction control in this Lexus, funnily enough, it actually works exactly like an Audi's traction control system does. So if you want to turn it off once, or like to a sport setting, you just press the button like that. And then if you want to turn it all the way off, you basically hold it down for 5 seconds and then you'll get a logo on the dash telling you that it's all the way off. Now the reason you can't do that sometimes is because it won't let you do it when you're moving. You have to be stationary. And I noticed in the CT200, if it detected slip with the traction off, for some reason it would try and turn the system back on again. So hopefully this car doesn't do it this time. So we're going to go gearbox into sports mode, and then we are going to go into sports mode and use the paddles, sort of. I mean, I guess I can use them to downshift. Upshifting with them is fairly pointless. In fact, now we're in sports mode, let me see what happens if I put my foot down. Oh yeah, so it sort of upshifts. Let's give that one more go. It's weird. It's not like a normal gearbox, even though it's trying to mimic one. Right, okay, so sports mode, traction off, sports for gearbox, sort of manual. Let's see what we can get out of this thing. Acceleration is very good, actually, I have to say. Turning is good. Yeah, it's a fairly neutral chassis, actually. Don't think you're going to be doing any power slides, though. Let's give it some. No. It's just a neutral chassis. The acceleration is good, and because it's a V6, even though it's got that like horrible CVT whine, it's not too bad. I mean, it's not blessing your eardrums with wonderful noises, but it's bearable. And like getting up to 70, it does it pretty quick. Brakes are good. Once you're at higher speeds, that transition between the regen system and the disc brakes is actually not that bad. But it's that acceleration from a get-go, like already 40 miles an hour. It's fairly decent, really. Online it says 0-60 in 8.4 seconds, but this is more like 7.6, 7.9. It's a fairly nippy car. And handling around faster corners. Yeah, front end grips well, steering is predictable. You know, I'm finding it hard to fault this thing, like genuinely. Like chassis wise, it's really not far off a BMW. It doesn't quite have the lightness of that, like, behind the steering wheel, but... I mean, that's mainly because this thing weighs 1.7 tonnes. I'm going to go around again, actually. I'm not bored yet. Look at the front end grip. My God, I mean... A GTI would struggle to keep up around those corners with this thing. That is weird. To put it in context, a Mercedes S-Class starts losing grip at about 34 miles an hour around that roundabout, even with good tyres on. This is running like fairly average tyres. A BMW 3 Series starts losing grip at about 40, and this is doing the same thing. This is a good chassis. It understeers a tiny bit more than a BMW 3 Series, but we're talking like 5% more. It's nothing like an Audi A4 where it just kind of lets go at the earliest opportunity. You have to get a Quattro A4 to actually get any kind of good driving dynamics out of the thing. But this being rear-wheel drive, just normally, means you kind of get a nice steering feel. Nice push around the corner. You can get a lick on in this thing. And it's not boring, surprisingly. I thought it was going to be totally inert from behind the wheel, but it's not. Steering feel is there, and it's pretty good. Going to be doing any drifting, but it's enjoyable to drive. Actually, quite looking forward to getting it down a slightly tighter B road. Let's go and find out, I suppose. Right, let's find out what it's like down a tighter B road then. Car is not that big, like a 3 Series. Ooh, a bit of slip from the rear then. And yeah, it's good. I know where the car is, I can feel what the front end's doing. Suspension is dealing with the UK roads well. See what it's like over this bump. There's actually a bit of slip. How about that? Do you know what? This is not half bad. Car's shouting at me there. Again, it's not going to let you slip the rear. But I think that's because there's just not quite enough power to do so. Or the way the power comes in is slightly too smooth. What a cracking bit of kit, I have to say.
So, why should 90% of drivers be buying this car? Well, most people need something that is just an A to B, and this does the mundane driving better than just about anything else you'll see on the road. The seats are just that much more comfortable, the fuel economy is, well, just better, and most importantly, the car is reliable every single day of the year. As a daily driver, you'll struggle to find anything nicer for the money. So if you're in the market for a new car or a used car, then take a moment and seriously consider one of these. As always, I hope you enjoyed this review. If you did, give it a like and why not subscribe, as not only can you see more content like this, you can see everything we have for sale, which includes this pristine Lexus IS300h. My name's Tom, and you've been watching Paragon Cars. I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.